Galactic North by Alastair Reynolds. Narrated by John Lee. Copyright 2006 by Alastair Reynolds. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Alastair Reynolds and United Agents and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Great Wall of Mars.
You realize you might die down there, said Warren.
Neville Clavain looked into his brother's one good eye, the one the conjoiners had left him with after the Battle of Tharsis Bulge.
Yes, I know, he said, but if there's another war, we might all die. I'd rather take that risk if there's a chance for peace.
Warren shook his head slowly and patiently. No matter how many times we've been over this, you just don't seem to get it, do you? There can't ever be any kind of peace while they're still down there. That's what you don't understand, Neville. The only long-term solution here is... He trailed off.
Go on, Clavain goaded. Say it. Genocide.
Warren might have been about to answer when there was a bustle of activity along the docking tube at the far end from the waiting spacecraft. Through the door, Clavain saw a throng of media people, then someone gliding through them, fielding questions with only the curtest of answers. That was Sandra Voy, the Demarchist woman who would be accompanying him to Mars. It's not genocide when they're just a faction, not an ethnically distinct race, Warren said before Voy was within earshot.
What is it, then?
I don't know.
Prudence?
Voy approached. She carried herself stiffly, her face a mask of quiet resignation. Her ship had only just docked from Circum-Jove after a 3-week transit at maximum burn. During that time, the prospects for a peaceful resolution of the current crisis had steadily deteriorated.
Welcome to Deimos, Warren said.
Marshals, she said, addressing them both, I wish the circumstances were better. Let's get straight to business. Warren, how long do you think we have to find a solution?
Not long. If Galliana maintains the pattern she's been following for the last 6 months, we're due another escape attempt in...
Warren glanced at a readout buried in his cuff, about 3 days. If she does try to get another shuttle off Mars, we'll really have no option but to escalate. They all knew what that would mean, a military strike against the conjoiner nest.
You've tolerated her attempt so far, Voy said, and each time you've successfully destroyed her ship with all the people in it. The net risk of a successful breakout hasn't increased, so why retaliate now?
It's very simple, Warren said. After each violation, we issued Galliana a stronger warning than the one before. Our last was absolute and final.
You'll be in violation of treaty if you attack.
Warren's smile was one of quiet triumph. Not quite, Sandra. You may not be completely conversant with the treaty's fine print, but we've discovered that it allows us to storm Galliana's nest without breaking any terms. The technical phrase is a police action, I believe. Clavain saw that Voy was momentarily lost for words. That was hardly surprising. The treaty between the Coalition and the Conjoiners, which Voy's neutral Demarchists had helped draft, was the longest document in existence, apart from some obscure computer-generated mathematical proofs. It was supposed to be watertight, though only machines had ever read it from beginning to end, and only machines had ever stood a chance of finding the kind of loophole Warren was now brandishing.
No, she said. There's some mistake.
I'm afraid he's right, Clavain said. I've seen the natural language summaries, and there's no doubt about the legality of a police action. But it needn't come to that. I'm sure I can persuade Galliana not to make another escape attempt.
But if we should fail... Voy looked at Warren now. Neville and I could still be on Mars in 3 days.
Don't be, is my advice. Disgusted, Voy turned and stepped into the green cool of the shuttle. Clavain was left alone with his brother for a moment. Warren fingered the leathery patch over his ruined eye with the chrome gauntlet of his prosthetic arm, as if to remind Clavain of what the war had cost him, how little love he had for the enemy, even now.
We haven't got a chance of succeeding, have we? Clavain said. We're only going down there so you can say you explored all avenues of negotiation before sending in the troops. You actually want another damned war.
Don't be so defeatist, Warren said, shaking his head sadly, forever the older brother disappointed at his sibling's failings. It really doesn't become you.
It's not me who's defeatist, Clavain said.
No, of course not. Just do your best, little brother. Warren extended his hand for his brother to shake. Hesitating, Clavain looked again into his brother's good eye. What he saw there was an interrogator's eye, as pale, colorless, and cold as a midwinter sun. There was hatred in it. Warren despised Clavain's pacifism, Clavain's belief that any kind of peace, even a peace that consisted only of stumbling episodes of mistrust between crises, was always better than war. That schism had fractured any lingering fraternal feelings they might have retained. Now, when Warren reminded Clavain that they were brothers, he never entirely concealed the disgust in his voice.
"You misjudge me," Clavain whispered, before quietly shaking Warren's hand.
"No, I honestly don't think I do." Clavain stepped through the airlock just before it sphinctered shut. Voy had already buckled herself in. She had a glazed look now, as if staring into infinity. Clavain guessed she was uploading a copy of the treaty through her implants, scrolling it across her visual field, trying to find the loophole. Probably running a global search for any reference to police actions. The ship recognized Clavain, its interior shivering to his preferences. The green was closer to turquoise now, the readouts and controls minimalist in layout, displaying only the most mission-critical systems. Though the shuttle was the tiniest peacetime vessel Clavain had been in, it was a cathedral compared to the dropships he had flown during the war. Vessels so small that they were assembled around their occupants like medieval armor just before a joust.
"Don't worry about the treaty," Clavain said. "I promise you, Warren won't get his chance to exploit that loophole."
Voy snapped out of her trance, irritatedly.
"You'd better be right, Neville. Is it me or is your brother hoping we fail?"
She was speaking Quebecois French now, Clavain shifting mental gears to follow her.
"If my people discover there's a hidden agenda here, they'll be hell to pay."
"The conjoiners gave Warren plenty of reason to hate them after the Battle of the Bulge," Clavain said, "and he's a tactician, not a field specialist. After the ceasefire, my knowledge of worms was even more valuable than before, so I had a role. But Warren's skills were a lot less transferable."
"So that gives him a right to edge us closer to another war."
The way voice spoke, it was as if her own side had not been neutral during the last exchange. But Clavain knew she was right. If hostilities between the conjoiners and the coalition reignited, the Demarchi would not be able to stand on the sidelines as they had 15 years ago, and it was anyone's guess how they would align themselves this time around.
"There won't be war."
"And if you can't reason with Galiana, are you going to play on your personal connection?"
"I was just her prisoner, that's all."
Clavain took the controls. Voy said piloting was a bore, and unlatched the shuttle from Deimos. They dropped away at a tangent to the rotation of the equatorial ring that girdled the moon, instantly in freefall. Clavain sketched a porthole in the wall with his fingertip, outlining a rectangle that instantly became transparent. For a moment he saw his reflection in the glass. Older than he felt he had any right to look, the grey beard and hair making him appear ancient rather than patriarchal, a man deeply wearied by recent circumstance. With some relief, he darkened the cabin so that he could see Deimos, dwindling at surprising speed. The higher of the two Martian moons was a dark, bristling lump infested with armaments, belted by the bright, window-studded band of the moving ring. For the last 9 years, Deimos was all he had known, but now he could encompass it within the arc of his fist.
"Not just her prisoner," Voy said. "No one else came back sane from the conjoiners. She never even tried to infect you with her machines."
"No, she didn't, but only because the timing was on my side."
Clavain was reciting an old argument now, as much for his own benefit as Voy's.
"I was the only prisoner she had. She was losing the war by then. One more recruit to her side wouldn't have made any real difference.
The terms of ceasefire were being thrashed out, and she knew she could buy herself favors by releasing me unharmed. There was something else, too. Conjoiners weren't supposed to be capable of anything so primitive as mercy. They were spiders, as far as we were concerned. Galliana's act threw a wrench into our thinking. It divided alliances within high command. If she hadn't released me, they might well have nuked her out of existence.
So there was absolutely nothing personal?
No, Clavaine said. There was nothing personal about it at all.
Voy nodded, without in any way suggesting that she actually believed him. It was a skill some women had honed to perfection, Clavaine reflected.
Of course, he respected Voy completely. She had been one of the first human beings to enter Europa's ocean decades back. Now they were planning fabulous cities under the ice, efforts she had spearheaded.
Demarchist society was supposedly flat in structure, non-hierarchical. But someone of Voy's brilliance ascended through echelons of her own making. She had been instrumental in brokering the peace between the Conjoiners and Clavaine's own coalition. That was why she was coming along now. Galliana had only agreed to Clavaine's mission provided he was accompanied by a neutral observer, and Voy had been the obvious choice. Respect was easy. Trust, however, was more difficult. It required that Clavaine ignore the fact that, with her head dotted with implants, the Demarchist woman's condition was not very far removed from that of the enemy. The descent to Mars was hard and steep. Once or twice they were queried by the automated tracking systems of the satellite interdiction network. Dark weapons hovering in Mars' synchronous orbit above the nest locked onto the ship for a few instants, magnetic railguns powering up, before the shuttle's diplomatic nature was established and it was allowed to proceed. The interdiction was very efficient, as well it might be, given that Clavaine had designed much of it himself. In 15 years no ship had entered or left the Martian atmosphere, nor had any surface vehicle ever escaped from Galliana's nest.
"There she is," Clavaine said, as the great wall rose over the horizon.
"Why do you call it a she?"
Voy asked. "I never felt the urge to personalize it, and I designed it. Besides, even if it was alive once, it's dead now."
She was right, but the wall was still awesome to behold. Seen from orbit, it was a pale circular ring on the surface of Mars, 2,000 kilometers wide. Like a coral atoll, it entrapped its own weather system, a disk of bluer air flecked with creamy white clouds that stopped abruptly at the boundary. Once, hundreds of communities had sheltered inside that cell of warm, thick, oxygen-rich atmosphere. The wall was the most audacious and visible of Voy's projects. The logic had been inescapable, a means to avoid the millennia-long timescales needed to terraform Mars via such conventional schemes as cometary bombardment or ice cap thawing. Instead of modifying the whole atmosphere at once, the wall allowed the initial effort to be concentrated in a relatively small region, at first only 1,000 kilometers across. There were no craters deep enough, so the wall had been completely artificial. A vast ring-shaped atmospheric dam designed to move slowly outward, encompassing ever more surface area at a rate of 20 kilometers per year. The wall needed to be very tall, because the low Martian gravity meant that the column of atmosphere was higher for a fixed surface pressure than on Earth. The ramparts were hundreds of meters thick, dark as glacial ice, sinking great taproots deep into the lithosphere to harvest the ores needed for the wall's continual growth. Yet 200 kilometers higher, the wall was a diaphanously thin membrane only microns wide, completely invisible except when rare optical effects made it hang like a frozen aurora against the stars. Eco-engineers had seeded the livable area circumscribed by the wall with Terran gene stocks deftly altered in orbital labs. Flora and fauna had moved out in vivacious waves, lapping eagerly against the constraints of the wall. But the wall was dead. It had stopped growing during the war, hit by some sort of viral weapon that crippled its replicating subsystems, and now even the ecosystem within it was failing, the atmosphere cooling, oxygen bleeding into space, pressure declining inevitably towards the Martian norm of 1/7,000th of an atmosphere. He wondered how it must look to Voy, whether in any sense she saw it as her murdered child.
"I'm sorry we had to kill it," Clavain said.
He was about to add that it had been the kind of act that war normalized, but decided the statement would have sounded hopelessly defensive.
"You needn't apologize," Voy said. "It was only machinery. I'm surprised it's lasted as long as it has, frankly. There must still be some residual damage repair capability. We Demarchists build for posterity, you know."
Yes, and it worried Clavain's own side. There was talk of challenging the Demarchist supremacy in the outer solar system, perhaps even an attempt to gain a coalition foothold around Jupiter.
They skimmed the top of the wall and punched through the thickening layers of atmosphere within it, the shuttle's hull morphing to an arrowhead shape. The ground had an arid, bleached look to it, dotted here and there with ruined shacks, broken domes, gutted vehicles, and shot-down shuttles. There were patches of shallow-rooted, mainly dark red tundra vegetation, cotton grass, saxifrage, arctic poppies and lichen. Clavain knew each species by its distinct infrared signature, but many of the plants were in recession now that the imported bird species had died. Ice lay in great silver swathes, and what few expanses of open water remained were warmed by buried thermopiles. Elsewhere, whole zones had reverted to almost sterile permafrost. It could have been a kind of paradise, Clavain thought, had the war not ruined everything. Yet what had happened here could only be a foretaste of the devastation that would follow across the system, on Earth, as well as Mars, if another war was allowed to happen.
"Do you see the nest yet?" Voy said.
"Wait a second," Clavain said,
requesting a head-up display that boxed the nest.
"That's it. A nice fat thermal signature, too. Nothing else for kilometers around. Nothing inhabited, anyway."
"Yes, I see it now."
The conjoiner nest lay a third of the way from the wall's edge, not far from the footslopes of Arsia Mons. The entire encampment was only a kilometer across, circled by a dike piled high with regolith dust on one side. The area within the Great Wall was large enough to have an appreciable weather system, spanning enough Martian latitude for significant Coriolis effects, enough longitude for diurnal warming and cooling to cause thermal currents. He could see the nest much more clearly now, details leaping out of the haze. Its external layout was crushingly familiar. Clavain's side had been studying the nest from the vantage point of Deimos ever since the ceasefire. Phobos, with its lower orbit, would have been even better, of course, but there was no helping that, and perhaps the Phobos problem might actually prove useful in his negotiations with Galliana. She was somewhere in the nest, he knew, somewhere beneath the 20 varyingly sized domes emplaced within the rim, linked together by pressurized tunnels or merged at their boundaries like soap bubbles. The nest extended several tens of levels beneath the Martian surface, maybe deeper.
"How many people do you think are inside?" Voy said.
900 or so, said Clavain. "That's an estimate based on my experience as a prisoner and the 100 or so who've died trying to escape since. The rest, I have to say, is pretty much guesswork."
"Our estimates aren't dissimilar.
1,000 or less here, and perhaps another 3 or 4 spread across the system in smaller nests. I know your side thinks we have better intelligence than that, but it happens not to be the case."
"Actually, I believe you."
The shuttle's airframe was flexing around them, morphing to a low-altitude profile with wide, bat-like wings.
"I was just hoping you might have some clue as to why Galliana keeps wasting valuable lives on pointless escape attempts."
Voy shrugged.
"Maybe to her the lives aren't anywhere near as valuable as you'd like to think."
"Do you honestly believe that?"
"I'm not sure we can even begin to guess the thinking of a true hive-mind society, Clavain, even from a Demarchist standpoint."
There was a chirp from the console, Galliana signaling them. Clavain opened the channel allocated for Coalition Conjoiner Diplomacy.
"Neville Clavain," he heard.
"Yes." He tried to sound as calm as possible. "I'm with Sandra Voy. We're ready to land as soon as you show us where."
"Okay," Galliana said. "Vector your ship towards the westerly rim wall. And please, be careful."
Thank you. Any particular reason for the caution?
Just be quick about it, Neville.
They banked over the nest, shedding height until they were skimming only a few tens of meters above the weather-worn Martian surface. A wide rectangular door had opened in the concrete dike, revealing a hangar bay aglow with yellow lights.
That must be where Galliana launches her shuttles from, Clavain whispered. We always thought there had to be some kind of opening on the western side of the rim, but we never had a good view of it before.
Which still doesn't tell us why she does it, Voy said.
The consul chirped again, the link poor, even though they were so close.
Nose up, Galliana said. You're too low and slow. Get some altitude or the worms will lock onto you.
You're telling me there are worms here, Clavain said.
I thought you were the worm expert, Neville.
He nosed the shuttle up, but fractionally too late. Ahead of them something coiled out of the ground with lightning speed, metallic jaws opening in its blunt, armored head. He recognized the type immediately. Ouroboros class. Worms of this form still infested 100 niches across the system. Not quite as smart as the type infesting Phobos, but still adequately dangerous.
Shit!
Voy said, have an air of Demarchist cool cracking for an instant.
You said it, Clavain answered.
The Ouroboros passed underneath them, and then there was a spine-jarring series of bumps as the jaws tore into the shuttle's belly. Clavain felt the shuttle lurch down, sickeningly. No longer a flying thing, but an exercise in ballistics. The cool, minimalist turquoise interior shifted liquidly into an emergency configuration, damage readouts competing for attention with weapon status options. Their seats ballooned around them.
Hold on, he said. We're going down.
Voice calm returned.
Do you think we can reach the rim in time?
Not a cat in hell's chance.
He wrestled with the controls all the same, but it was no good. The ground was coming up fast and hard. I wish Galliana had warned us a bit sooner.
I think she thought we already knew.
They hit. The impact was harder than Clavain had been expecting. But the shuttle stayed in one piece, and the seat cushioned him from the worst of it. They skidded for a few meters and then nosed up against a sandbank. Through the window, Clavain saw the white worm racing towards them with undulating waves of its segmented robot body.
I think we're finished, Voy said.
Not quite, Clavain said. You're not going to like this, but...
Biting his tongue, he brought the shuttle's hidden weapons online. An aiming scope plunged down from the ceiling. He brought his eyes to it and locked crosshairs onto the Ouroboros. Just like old times.
Damn you! Voy said. This was meant to be an unarmed mission.
You're welcome to lodge a formal complaint.
Clavain fired, the hull shaking from the recoil. Through the side window they watched the white worm blow apart into stubby segments. The parts wriggled beneath the dust.
Good shooting, Voy said almost grudgingly. Is it dead?
For now, Clavain said. It'll take several hours for the segments to fuse back into a functional worm.
Good, Voy said, pushing herself out of her seat. But there will be a formal complaint, take my word.
Maybe you'd rather the worm had eaten us.
I just hate duplicity, Clavain.
He tried the radio again.
Galliana, we're down. The ship's history, but we're both unharmed.
Thank God.
Old verbal mannerisms died hard, even amongst the conjoined. But you can't stay where you are. There are more worms in the area. Do you think you can make it overland to the nest?
It's only 200 meters, Voy said. It shouldn't be a problem.
200 meters, yes, Clavain thought, but 200 meters across treacherous, potholed ground, riddled with enough soft depressions to hide a dozen worms.
And then they would have to climb up the rim side to reach the entrance to the hangar bay, 10 or 15 meters above the soil at least.
Let's hope it isn't, Clavain said.
He unbuckled, feeling lightheaded, as he stood for the first time in Martian gravity. He had adapted entirely too well to the 1G of the Deimos ring, constructed for the comfort of Earthside tacticians. He went to the emergency locker and found a mask, which slithered eagerly across his face, another for Voy. They plugged in air tanks and went to the shuttle's door.
This time when its sphincter opened, there was a glistening membrane stretched across the doorway, a recently licensed item of Demarchist technology. Clavain pushed through the membrane and the stuff enveloped him with a wet, sucking sound. By the time he hit the dirt, the membrane had hardened itself around his soles and had begun to contour itself around his body, forming ribs and accordioned joints while remaining transparent. Voy exited behind him, gaining her own M-suit. They loped away from the crashed shuttle towards the dike. The worms would be locking onto their seismic patterns already, if there were any nearby. They might be more interested in the shuttle for now, but they couldn't count on it. Clavain knew the behavior of worms intimately, knew the major routines that drove them, but that expertise did not guarantee his survival. It had almost failed him in Phobos. The mask felt clammy against his face. The air at the base of the Great Wall was technically breathable even now, but there was no point in taking chances when speed was of the essence. His feet scuffed through the topsoil, and while he felt as if he was crossing ground, the dike obstinately refused to come any closer. It was larger than it had looked from the crash site, the distance further.
"Another worm," Voy said.
White coils erupted through sand to the west. The Ouroboros was making undulating progress towards them, zigzagging with predatory calm, knowing that it could afford to take its time. In the tunnels of Phobos, they had never had the luxury of knowing when a worm was close. They struck from ambush, quick as pythons.
"Run," Clavain said.
Dark figures appeared in the opening high in the rim wall. A rope ladder unfurled down the side of the structure. Clavain, making for the base of it, made no effort to quieten his footfalls. He knew that the worm almost certainly had a lock on him by now. He looked back. The worm paused by the downed shuttle, then smashed its diamond-jawed head into the ship, impaling the hull on its body. The worm reared up, wearing the ship like a garland. Then it shivered and the ship flew apart like a rotten carcass. The worm returned its attention to Clavain and Voy. Like a sidewinder, it pulled its 30-meter-long body from the sand and rolled towards them on wheeling coils. Clavain reached the base of the ladder. Once, he could have ascended the ladder with his arms alone in 1G, but now the ladder felt alive beneath his feet. He began to climb, then realized that the ground was dropping away much faster than he was passing rungs. The conjoiners were hauling him aloft. He looked back in time to see Voy stumble.
"Sandra, no!"
She made to stand up, but it was too late by then. As the worm descended on her, Clavain could do nothing but turn his gaze away and pray for her death to be quick. If it had to be meaningless, he thought, at least let it be swift. Then he started thinking about his own survival.
"Faster!"
he shouted, but the mask reduced his voice to a panicked muffle. He had forgotten to assign the ship's radio frequency to the suit. The worm thrashed against the base of the wall, then began to rear up, its maw opening beneath him, a diamond-ringed orifice like the drill of a tunneling machine. Then something eye-hurtingly bright cut into the worm's hide. Craning his neck, Clavain saw a group of conjoiners leaning over the lip of the opening, aiming guns downward. The worm writhed in intense, robotic irritation. Across the sand, he could see the coils of other worms coming closer. There must have been dozens ringing the nest. No wonder Galliana's people had made so few attempts to leave by land. They had hauled him within 10 meters of safety. The injured worm showed cybernetic workings, where its hide had been flensed away by weapons impacts. Enraged, it flung itself against the rim wall, chipping off scabs of concrete the size of boulders. Clavain felt the vibration of each impact through the wall as he was dragged upwards. The worm hit again, and the wall shook more violently than before. To his horror, Clavain watched one of the conjoiners lose his footing and tumble over the edge of the rim towards him. Time oozed to a crawl. The falling man was almost upon him. Without thinking, Clavain hugged closer to the wall, locking his limbs around the ladder. Suddenly, he had seized the man by the arm. Even in Martian gravity, even allowing for the conjoiner's willowy build, the impact almost sent both of them careering towards the Ouroboros. Clavain felt his bones pop out of location, tearing at Gristle, but he managed to keep his grip on both the conjoiner and the ladder. Conjoiners breathed the air at the base of the wall without difficulty. The man wore only lightweight clothes, grey silk pyjamas belted at the waist. With his sunken cheeks and bald skull, the man's Martian physique lent him a cadaverous look, yet somehow he had managed not to drop his gun, still holding it in his other hand.
"Let me go," the man said.
Below, the worm inched higher despite the harm the conjoiners had inflicted on it.
"No,"
Clavain said through clenched teeth and the distorting membrane of his mask.
"I'm not letting you go."
"You've no option." The man's voice was placid. "They can't hold both of us up fast enough, Clavain." Clavain looked into the conjoiner's face, trying to judge the man's age. 30, perhaps. Maybe not even that, since his cadaverous visage probably made him appear older than he really was. Clavain was easily twice his age, had surely lived a richer life, had comfortably cheated death on 3 or 4 previous occasions.
"I'm the one who should die, not you."
"No," the conjoiner said. "They'd find a way to blame your death on us. They'd make it a pretext for war." Without any fuss, the man pointed the gun at his own head and blew his brains out. As much in shock as recognition that the man's life was no longer his to save, Clavain released his grip. The dead man tumbled down the rim wall, into the mouth of the worm that had just killed Sandra Voy. Numb, Clavain allowed himself to be pulled to safety. When the armored door to the hangar was shut, the conjoiners attacked his M-suit with enzymic sprays. The sprays digested the fabric of the M-suit in seconds, leaving Clavain wheezing in a pool of slime. Then a pair of conjoiners helped him unsteadily to his feet and waited patiently while he caught his breath through the mask. Through tears of exhaustion, he saw that the hangar was racked full of half-assembled spacecraft, skeletal geodesic shark shapes designed to punch out of an atmosphere fast.
"Sandra Voy is dead," he said, removing the mask to speak.
There was no way the conjoiners could not have seen that for themselves, but it felt inhuman not to acknowledge what had happened. "I know," Galliana said, "but at least you survived." He thought of the man falling into the Ouroboros.
"I'm sorry about your..."
But then he trailed off, because for all his depth of knowledge concerning the conjoiners, he had no idea what the appropriate term was.
"You placed your life in danger trying to save him."
"He didn't have to die."
Galliana nodded sagely.
"No, in all likelihood he didn't. But the risk to you was too great. You heard what he said. Your death would be made to appear our fault, justification for a preemptive strike against our nest. Even the Demarchists would turn against us if we were seen to murder a diplomat."
Taking another suck from the mask, he looked into her face. He had spoken to her over low bandwidth video links, but only in person was it obvious that Galliana had hardly aged in 15 years. A decade and a half of habitual expression should have engraved existing lines deeper into her face, but conjoiners were not known for their facial expression. Galliana had seen little sunlight in the intervening time, cooped up there in the nest, and Martian gravity was much kinder to bone structure than the 1G of Deimos. She still had the cruel beauty he remembered from his time as a prisoner. The only real evidence of aging lay in the filaments of grey threading her hair, raven black when she had been his captor.
"Why didn't you warn us about the worms?"
"Warn you?" For the first time, something like doubt crossed her face, but it was only fleeting. "We assumed you were fully aware of the Ouroboros infestation. Those worms have been dormant, waiting, for years, but they've always been there. It was only when I saw how low your approach was that I realized
that we might not have known."
Worms were area denial devices, autonomous prey-seeking minds. The war had left many pockets of the solar system still riddled with active worms. The machines were intelligent in a one-dimensional way. Nobody ever admitted to deploying them, and it was usually impossible to convince them that the war was over and that they should quietly deactivate. "After what happened to you in Phobos," Galliana said, "I assumed there was nothing you needed to be taught about worms." He never liked thinking about Phobos. The pain was still too deeply engraved. But if it had not been for the injuries he had sustained there, he would never have been sent to Deimos to recuperate, would never have been recruited into his brother's intelligence wing to study the conjoiners. Out of that phase of deep immersion in everything concerning the enemy had come his peacetime role as negotiator, and now diplomat, on the eve of another war. Everything was circular, ultimately, and now Phobos was central to his thinking because he saw it as a way out of the impasse, maybe the last chance for peace, but it was too soon to put his idea to Galliana. He was not even sure the mission could still continue after what had happened.
We're safe now, I take it.
Yes, we can repair the damage to the dike. Mostly we can ignore their presence.
We should have been warned. Look, I need to talk to my brother.
Warren, of course. It's easily arranged. They walked out of the hangar, away from the half-assembled ships. Somewhere deeper in the nest, Clavain knew, was a factory where the components for the ships were made, mined out of Mars or winnowed from the fabric of the nest. The conjoiners managed to launch one every 6 weeks or so, had been doing so for 6 months. Not one of the ships had ever managed to escape the Martian atmosphere before being shot down. But sooner or later he would have to ask Galliana why she persisted with this provocative folly. Now, though, was not the time. Even if, by Warren's estimate, he only had 3 days before Galliana's next provocation. The air elsewhere in the nest was thicker and warmer than in the hangar, which meant he could dispense with the mask. Galliana took him down a short, grey-walled metallic corridor that ended in a circular room containing a console. He recognized the room from the times he had spoken to Galliana from Deimos. Galliana showed him how to use the system, then left him in privacy while he established a connection with Deimos. Warren's face soon appeared on a screen, thick with pixels like an impressionist portrait. Conjoiners were only allowed to send kilobytes a second to other parts of the system. Much of that bandwidth was now being sucked up by this one video link.
"You've heard, I take it," Clavain said.
Warren nodded, his face ashen. "We had a pretty good view from orbit, of course. Enough to see that Voy didn't make it.
Poor woman.
We were reasonably sure you'd survived, but it's good to have it confirmed."
"Do you want me to abandon the mission?"
Warren's hesitation was more than just time lag.
"No.
I thought about it, of course, and High Command agrees with me. Voy's death was tragic, no escaping that, but she was only along as a neutral observer. If Galliana consents for you to stay, I suggest you do so."
"But you still say I only have 3 days.
That's up to Galliana, isn't it? Have you learned much?"
"You must be kidding. I've seen shuttles ready for launch, that's all. I haven't raised the Phobos proposal yet either. The timing wasn't exactly ideal after what happened to Voy."
"Yes, if only we'd known about the Ouroboros infestation." Clavain leaned closer to the screen.
"Yes, why the hell didn't we? Galliana assumed that we would, and I don't blame her for that. We've had the nest under constant surveillance for 15 years. Surely in all that time we'd have seen evidence of the worms."
"You'd have thought so, wouldn't you?"
"Meaning what?"
"Meaning maybe the worms weren't always there." Conscious that there could be nothing private about this conversation, but unwilling to drop the thread, Clavain said,
"You think the conjoiners put them there to ambush us?"
"I'm saying we shouldn't disregard any possibility, no matter how unpalatable."
"Galliana would never do something like that."
"No, I wouldn't." She had just stepped back into the room, "and I'm disappointed that you'd even debate the possibility." Clavain terminated the link with Deimos.
"Eavesdropping's not a very nice habit, you know."
"What did you expect me to do?"
"Show some trust? Or is that too much of a stretch?"
"I never had to trust you when you were my prisoner," Galliana said. "That made our relationship infinitely simpler. Our roles were completely defined."
"And now? If you distrust me so completely, why did you ever agree to my visit? Plenty of other specialists could have come in my place. You could even have refused any dialogue."
"Voy's people pressured us to allow your visit," Galliana said, "just as they pressured your side into delaying hostilities a little longer."
"Is that all?"
She hesitated slightly now.
"I knew you."
"Knew me? Is that how you sum up a year of imprisonment? What about the thousands of conversations we had? The times when we put aside our differences to talk about something other than the damned war? You kept me sane, Galeana. I've never forgotten that. It's why I've risked my life to come here to talk you out of another provocation. It's completely different now.
Of course.
He forced himself not to shout. Of course, it's different, but not fundamentally. We can still build on that bond of trust and find a way out of this crisis.
But does your side really want a way out of it?
He did not answer her immediately, wary of what the truth might mean. I'm not sure. But I'm not sure you do either, or else you wouldn't keep pushing your luck.
Something snapped inside him, and he asked the question he had meant to ask in a million better ways.
Why do you keep doing it, Galeana? Why do you keep launching those ships when you know they'll be shot down as soon as they leave the nest?
Her eyes locked onto his unflinchingly.
Because we can. Because sooner or later one will succeed.
Clavain nodded. It was exactly the sort of thing he had feared she would say. She led him through more grey-walled corridors, descending several levels deeper into the nest. Light poured from snaking strips embedded into the walls like arteries. It was possible that the snaking design was decorative, but Clavain thought it much more likely that the strips had simply grown that way, expressing biological algorithms. There was no evidence that the conjoiners had attempted to enliven their surroundings, to render them in any sense human.
"It's a terrible risk you're running," Clavain said.
"And the status quo is intolerable. I've every desire to avoid another war. But if it came to one, we'd at least have the chance to break these shackles."
"If you didn't get exterminated first."
"We'd avoid that. In any case, fear plays no part in our thinking. You saw the man accept his fate on the dike. When he understood that your death would harm us more than his own, he altered his state of mind to one of total acceptance."
"Fine. That makes it all right, then."
She halted. They were alone in one of the snakingly lit corridors. He had seen no other conjoiners since the hangar. "It's not that we regard individual lives as worthless, any more than you would willingly sacrifice a limb. But now that we're part of something larger..."
"Trans-enlightenment, you mean?"
It was the conjoiner's term for the state of neural communion they shared, mediated by the machines swarming in their skulls. Whereas Demarchists used implants to facilitate real-time democracy, conjoiners used them to share sensory data, memories, even conscious thought itself. That was what had precipitated the war. Back in 2190, half of humanity had been hooked into the system-wide data nets via neural implants. Then the conjoiner experiments had exceeded some threshold, unleashing a transforming virus into the nets. Implants had begun to change, infecting millions of minds with the templates of conjoiner thought. Instantly, the infected had become the enemy. Earth and the other inner planets had always been more conservative, preferring to access the nets via traditional media. Once they saw communities on Mars and in the asteroid belts fall prey to the conjoiner phenomenon, the coalition powers hurriedly pooled their resources to prevent it from spreading to their own states. The Demarchists, out around the gas giants, had managed to get firewalls up before many of their habitats were lost. They had chosen neutrality while the coalition tried to contain, some said sterilize, zones of conjoiner takeover. Within 3 years, after some of the bloodiest battles in human experience, the conjoiners had been pushed back to a clutch of hideaways dotted around the system. Yet all along they professed a kind of puzzled bemusement that their spread was being resisted. After all, no one who had been assimilated seemed to regret it. Quite the contrary. The few prisoners whom the conjoiners had reluctantly returned to their pre-infection state had sought every means to re-enter the fold. Some had even chosen suicide rather than be denied trans-enlightenment. Like acolytes given a vision of heaven, they devoted their entire waking existence to the search for another glimpse.
"Trans-enlightenment blurs our sense of self," Galeana said. "When the man elected to die, the sacrifice was not absolute for him. He understood that much of what he was had already achieved preservation amongst the rest of us."
"But he was just one man. What about the 100 lives you've thrown away with your escape attempts?
We know. We've counted the bodies.
Replacements can always be cloned.
Clavain hoped that he hid his disgust satisfactorily. Amongst his people, the very notion of cloning was an unspeakable atrocity, redolent with horror. To Galliana, it would be just another technique in her arsenal.
But you don't clone, do you? And you're losing people. We thought there would be 900 of you in this nest, but that was a gross overestimate, wasn't it?
You haven't seen much of it yet, Galliana said.
No, but this place smells deserted. You can't hide absence, Galliana. I bet there aren't more than 100 of you left here.
You're wrong, Galliana said. We have cloning technology, but we've hardly ever used it. What would be the point? We don't aspire to genetic unity, no matter what your propagandists think. The pursuit of optima leads only to local minima. We honor our errors. We actively seek persistent disequilibrium.
Right. The last thing he needed now was a dose of conjoiner rhetoric. So where the hell is everyone?
In a while he had part of the answer, if not the whole of it. At the end of the maze of corridors, deep under the Martian surface now, Galliana brought him to a nursery. It was shockingly unlike his expectations. Not only did it not match what he had imagined from the vantage point of Deimos, but it jarred against his predictions based on what he had seen so far of the nest. In Deimos, he had assumed the conjoiner nursery would be a place of grim medical efficiency, all gleaming machines with babies plugged in like peripherals, like a monstrously productive doll factory. Within the nest, he had revised his model to allow for the depleted numbers of conjoiners. If there was a nursery, it was obviously not very productive. Fewer babies then, but still a vision of hulking grey machines bathed in snaking light. The nursery was nothing like that. The huge room Galliana showed him was almost painfully bright and cheerful, a child's fantasy of friendly shapes and primary colours. The walls and ceiling projected a holographic sky, infinite blue and billowing clouds of heavenly white. The floor was an undulating mat of synthetic grass, forming hillocks and meadows. There were banks of flowers and forests of bonsai trees. There were robot animals, fabulous birds and rabbits just slightly too anthropomorphic to fool Clavain. They were like the animals in children's books, big-eyed and happy-looking. Toys were scattered on the grass. And there were children. They numbered between 40 and 50, spanning by his estimate ages from a few months to 6 or 7 standard years. Some were crawling amongst the rabbits. Other older children were gathered around tree stumps, whose sheared-off surfaces flickered rapidly with images, underlighting their faces. They were talking amongst themselves, giggling or singing. He counted perhaps 6 adult conjoiners kneeling with the children. The children's clothes were a headache of bright, clashing colours and patterns. The conjoiners crouched amongst them like ravens. Yet the children looked at ease with them, listening attentively when the adults had something to say.
This isn't what you thought it would be like, is it?
No, not at all.
There was no point lying to her.
We thought you'd raise your young in a simplified version of the machine-generated environment you experience.
In the early days, that's more or less what we did.
Subtly, Galliana's tone of voice had changed. Do you know why chimpanzees are less intelligent than humans? He blinked at the change of tack.
I don't know. Are their brains smaller?
Yes, but a dolphin's brain is larger, and they're scarcely more intelligent than dogs. Galliana stooped next to a vacant tree stump. Without apparently doing anything, she made a diagram of mammal brain anatomies appear on the trunk's upper surface, then sketched her finger across the relevant parts. It's not overall brain volume that counts, so much as the developmental history. The difference in brain volume between a neonatal chimp and an adult is only about 20%. By the time the chimp receives any data from beyond the womb, there's almost no plasticity left to use. Similarly, dolphins are born with almost their complete repertoire of adult behavior already hardwired. A human brain, on the other hand, keeps growing through years of learning. We inverted that thinking. If data received during postnatal growth was so crucial to intelligence,
Perhaps we could boost our intelligence even further by intervening during the earliest phases of brain development.
In the womb?
Yes. Now she made the tree stump show a human embryo running through cycles of cell division until the faint fold of a rudimentary spinal nerve began to form, nubbed with the tiniest of emergent minds. Droves of subcellular machines swarmed in, invading the nascent nervous system. Then the embryo's development slammed forward until Clavain was looking at an unborn human baby.
What happened?
It was a grave error, Galliana said. Instead of enhancing normal neural development, we impaired it terribly. All we ended up with were various manifestations of savant syndrome. Clavain looked around him.
So you let these kids develop normally?
More or less. There's no family structure, of course, but then again there are plenty of human and primate societies where the family is less important in child development than the cohort group. So far we haven't seen any pathologies. Clavain watched as one of the older children was escorted out of the grassy room, through a door in the sky. When the conjoiner reached the door, the child hesitated, tugging against the man's gentle insistence. The child looked back for a moment, then followed the man through the gap.
Where's that child going?
To the next stage of its development. Clavain wondered what the chances were of him seeing the nursery just as one of the children was being promoted. Small, he judged, unless there was a crash program to rush as many of them through as quickly as possible. As he thought about this, Galliana took him into another part of the nursery. While this room was smaller and dourer, it was still more colourful than any other part of the nest he had seen before the grassy room. The walls were a mosaic of crowded, intermingling displays, teeming with moving images and rapidly scrolling text. He saw a herd of zebra stampeding through the core of a neutron star. Elsewhere, an octopus squirted ink at the face of a 20th-century despot. Other display facets rose from the floor like Japanese paper screens, flooded with data. Children, up to early teenagers, sat on soft black toadstools next to the screens in little groups, debating. A few musical instruments lay around unused, hollow claviers and air guitars. Some of the children had grey bands around their eyes and were poking their fingers through the interstices of abstract structures, exploring the dragon-infested waters of mathematical space. Clavain could see what they were manipulating on the flat screens, shapes that made his head hurt, even in two dimensions.
They're nearly there, Clavain said. The machines are outside their heads, but not for long. When does it happen?
Soon. Very soon.
You're rushing them, aren't you? Trying to get as many children conjoined as you can. What are you planning?
Something has arisen. That's all. The timing of your arrival is either very bad or very fortunate, depending on one's point of view. Before he could query her, Galliana added, Clavain, I want you to meet someone.
Who?
Someone very precious to us. She took him through a series of child-proof doors until they reached a small circular room. The walls and ceiling were veined grey, tranquil after the last place. A child sat cross-legged on the floor in the middle of the room. Clavain estimated the girl's age as 10 standard years, perhaps fractionally older, but she did not respond to Clavain's presence in any way an adult or even a normal child would have. She just kept on doing the things she had been doing when they stepped inside, as if they were not really present at all. It was not particularly clear what she was doing. Her hands moved before her in slow, precise gestures. It was as if she were playing a hollow clavier or working a phantom puppet show. Now and then she would pivot around until she was facing another direction and carry on making the hand movements. Her name's Felka, Galliana said.
Hello, Felka.
Clavain waited for a response, but none came.
I can see there's something wrong with her.
She's one of the savants. Felka developed with machines in her head. She was the last to be born before we realized our failure. Something about Felka disturbed him. Perhaps it was the way she carried on regardless, engrossed in an activity to which she appeared to attribute the utmost significance, yet which had to be without any sane purpose.
She doesn't seem to be aware of us.
Her deficits are severe, Galliana said. She has no interest in other human beings. She has prosopagnosia, the inability to distinguish faces. We all look alike to her. Can you imagine something stranger than that? He tried and failed. Life from Felka's viewpoint must have been a nightmarish thing, surrounded by identical clones whose inner lives she could not begin to grasp. No wonder she was so engrossed in her game.
Why is she so precious to you?
Clavain asked, not really wanting to know the answer.
She's keeping us alive, Galliana said.
Of course, he asked Galliana what she meant by that. Galliana's only response was to tell him that he was not yet ready to be shown the answer.
And what exactly would it take for me to reach that stage?
A simple procedure.
Oh yes, he understood that part well enough.
Just a few machines in the right parts of his brain and the truth could be his. Politely, doing his best to mask his distaste, Clavain declined. Fortunately, Galliana did not press the point, for the time had arrived for the meeting he had been promised before his arrival on Mars. He watched a subset of the nest file into the conference room. Galliana was their leader only inasmuch as she had founded the lab from which the original experiment had sprung, and was accorded some respect deriving from seniority. She was also the most obvious spokesperson amongst them, but they all had areas of expertise that could not easily be shared amongst other conjoined, which distinguished them from the hive mind of identical clones that still figured in the coalition's propaganda. If the nest was in any way like an ant colony, then it was an ant colony in which every ant fulfilled a role distinct from all the others. Naturally, no individual could be solely entrusted with a particular skill essential to the nest. That would have been dangerous over specialization. But neither had individuality been completely subsumed into the group mind. The conference room must have dated back to the days when the nest was a research outpost, or even earlier, when it was some kind of mining base in the early 2100s. It was much too big for the dire handful of conjoiners who stood around the main table. Tactical readouts around the table showed the build-up of strike forces above the Martian exclusion zone, probable drop trajectories for ground force deployment. Neville Clavain, Galliana said, introducing him to the others. Everyone sat down. I'm just sorry that Sandra Voy can't be with us now. We all feel the tragedy of her death. But perhaps out of this terrible event we can find some common ground, Neville. Before you came here, you told us you had a proposal for a peaceful resolution to the crisis.
I'd really like to hear it, one of the others murmured audibly.
Clavain's throat was dry. Diplomatically, this was quicksand.
My proposal concerns Phobos.
Go on, Galliana invited.
I was injured there, he said, very badly. Our attempt to clean out the worm infestation failed, and I lost some good friends. That makes it personal between me and the worms. But I'd accept anyone's help to finish them off.
Galliana glanced quickly at her compatriots before answering, A joint assault operation?
It could work.
Yes. Galliana looked lost momentarily. I suppose it could be a way out of the impasse. Our own attempt failed too, and the interdictions stopped us from trying again. Again she seemed to fall into reverie. But who would really benefit from the flushing out of Phobos? We'd still be quarantined here. Clavain leaned forward.
A cooperative gesture might be exactly the thing to lead to a relaxation in the terms of the interdiction. But don't think of it that way. Think instead of reducing the current threat from the worms.
Threat?
Clavain nodded. It's possible that you haven't noticed. He leaned further forward, elbows on the table. We're concerned about the Phobos worms. They've begun altering the moon's orbit. The shift is tiny at the moment, but too large to be anything other than deliberate.
Galliana looked away from him for an instant, as if weighing her options, then said, We were aware of this, but you weren't to know that. Was that an indication of gratitude from Galliana? He had assumed the worm's activity could not have escaped Galliana.
We've seen odd behavior from other worm infestations across the system, things that begin to look like emergent intelligence,
but never anything this purposeful. The infestation must have come from a batch with some subroutines we never even guessed existed. Do you have any ideas about what they might be up to?"
Again there was the briefest of hesitations, as if she was communing with her compatriots for the right response. Then she nodded towards a male conjoiner sitting opposite her. Clavain, guessing that the gesture was entirely for his benefit. His hair was black and curly, his face as smooth and untroubled by expression as Galliana's, with something of the same beautifully symmetrical bone structure.
"This is Remontoir," said Galliana. "He's our specialist on the Phobos situation."
Remontoir nodded politely.
"In answer to your question, we currently have no viable theories as to what they're doing, but we do know one thing. They're raising the Apo Center of the moon's orbit."
Apo Center, Clavain knew, was the Martian equivalent of apogee for an object orbiting Earth, the point of highest altitude in an elliptical orbit. Remontoir continued, his voice as preternaturally calm as a parent reading slowly to a child. "The natural orbit of Phobos is actually inside the Roche limit for a gravitationally bound moon. Phobos is raising a tidal bulge on Mars, but, because of friction, the bulge can't quite keep up with Phobos. It's causing Phobos to spiral slowly closer to Mars, by about 2 meters a century. In a few tens of millions of years, what's left of the moon will crash into Mars."
"You think the worms are elevating the orbit to avoid a cataclysm so far in the future?"
"I don't know," Remontoir said. "I suppose the orbital alterations could also be a byproduct of some less meaningful worm activity."
"I agree," Clavain said, "but the danger remains. If the worms can elevate the moon's Apo center, even accidentally, we can assume they also have the means to lower its pericenter. They could drop Phobos on top of your nest. Does that scare you sufficiently that you'd consider cooperation with the Coalition?"
Galliana steepled her fingers before her face, a human gesture of deep concentration that her time as a conjoiner had not quite eroded. Clavain could almost feel the web of thought looming the room, ghostly strands of cognition reaching between each conjoiner at the table and beyond into the nest proper.
"A winning team. Is that your idea?" she said at length. "It's got to be better than war," Clavain said, "hasn't it?"
Galliana might have been about to answer when her face grew troubled. Clavain saw the wave of discomposure sweep over the others almost simultaneously. Something told him that it was nothing to do with his proposal. Around the table, half the display facet switched automatically over to another channel. The face that Clavain was looking at was much like his own, except that the face on the screen was missing an eye. It was his brother. Warren was overlaid with the official insignia of the Coalition and a dozen system-wide media cartels. He was in the middle of a speech.
"Express my shock," Warren said, "or for that matter my outrage. It's not just that they've murdered a valued colleague and a deeply experienced member of my team. They've murdered my brother."
Clavain felt the deepest of chills.
"What is this?"
"A live transmission from Deimos," Galliana breathed. "It's going out to all the nets, right out to the trans-Pluto habitats."
"What they did was an act of unspeakable treachery," Warren said. "Nothing less than the premeditated cold-blooded murder of a peace envoy."
And then a video clip sprang up to replace Warren. The image must have been snapped from Deimos, or one of the interdiction satellites. It showed Clavain's shuttle lying in the dust close to the dike. He watched the Ouroboros destroy the shuttle, then saw the image zoom in on himself and Voy running for sanctuary. The Ouroboros took Voy, but this time there was no ladder lowered down for him. Instead he saw weapon beams scythe out from the nest towards him, knocking him to the ground. Horribly wounded, he tried to get up, to crawl a few centimeters nearer to his tormentors, but the worm was already upon him. He watched himself get eaten. Warren was back again. "The worms around the nest were a conjoiner trap. My brother's death must have been planned days, maybe even weeks, in advance." His face was a granite-like mask of military composure. "There can only be one outcome from such an act, something the conjoiners must have well understood. For months they've been goading us towards hostile action." He paused, then nodded at an unseen audience. "Well, now they're going to get it. In fact,
Our response has already commenced.
Dear God, no,
Clavain said, but the evidence was everywhere now. All around the table he could see the updating orbital spread of the Coalition's dropships, knifing down towards Mars.
I think it's war, Galliana said.
Conjoiners stormed onto the roof of the nest, taking up defensive positions around the domes and the dike's edge. Most of them carried the same guns they had used against the Ouroboros. Smaller numbers were setting up automatic cannon on tripods. One or two were manhandling large anti-assault weapons into position. Most of it was war surplus. 15 years ago, the Conjoiners had avoided extinction by deploying weapons of awesome ferocity. But those ship-to-ship armaments were simply too destructive to use against a nearby foe. Now it would be more visceral, closer to the primal templates of combat, and none of what the Conjoiners were marshalling would be much use against the kind of assault Warren had prepared, Clavain knew. They could slow an attack, but not much more than that. Galliana had given him another breather mask, made him don lightweight camelioflage armor, and then forced him to carry one of the smaller guns. The gun felt alien in his hands, something he had never expected to carry again. The only possible justification for carrying it was to use it against his brother's forces, against his own side.
Could he do that?
It was clear that Warren had betrayed him. He had surely been aware of the worms around the nest, so his brother was capable not just of contempt, but of treacherous murder. For the first time, Clavain felt genuine hatred for Warren. He must have hoped that the worms would destroy the shuttle completely and kill Clavain and Voy in the process. It must have pained him to see Clavain make it to the dike, pained him even more when Clavain called to talk about the tragedy. But Warren's larger plan had not been affected. The diplomatic link between the Nest and Deimos was secure. Even the Demarchists had no immediate access to it, so Clavain's call from the surface could be quietly ignored. Spysat imagery doctored to make it appear as if he had never reached the dike, had in fact been repelled by Conjoiner treachery. Inevitably, the Demarchists would unravel the deception given time. But if Warren's plan succeeded, they would all be embroiled in war long before then. That, thought Clavain, was all that Warren had ever wanted. Two brothers, Clavain thought, in many ways so alike. Both had embraced war once, but like a fickle lover, Clavain had wearied of its glories. He had not even been injured as severely as Warren. But perhaps that was the point, too. Warren needed another war to avenge what one had stolen from him. Clavain despised and pitied him in equal measure. He searched for the safety clip on the gun. The rifle, now that he studied it more closely, was not all that different from those he had used during the war. The readout said the ammo cell was fully charged. He looked into the sky. The attack wave broke orbit hard and steep above the wall, 500 fireballs screeching towards the nest. The insertion scorched centimeters of ablative armor from most of the ships, fried a few others that came in just fractionally too hard. Clavain knew exactly what was happening. He had studied possible attack scenarios for years. The range of outcomes burned indelibly into his memory. The anti-assault guns were already working, locking onto the plasma trails as they flowered overhead, swinging down to find the tiny spark of heat at the head, computing refraction paths for laser pulses, spitting death into the sky. The unlucky ships flared a white that hurt the back of the eye and rained down in a billion dulling sparks. A dozen, then a dozen more, maybe 50 in total before the guns could no longer acquire targets. It was nowhere near enough. Clavain's memory of the simulations had told him that at least 400 units of the attack wave would survive both re-entry and the Conjoiner's heavy defenses. Nothing that Galliana could do would make any difference. And that had always been the paradox. Galliana was capable of running the same simulations. She must always have known that her provocations would bring down something she could never hope to defeat. Something that was always going to destroy her. The surviving members of the wave were leveling out now, commencing long, ground-hugging runs from all directions. Cocooned in their dropships, the soldiers would be suffering punishing G-loads, but it was nothing they were not engineered to withstand. Their cardiovascular systems had been augmented with the sort of non-neural implants the Coalition grudgingly tolerated. The first of the wave came arcing in at supersonic speeds,
All around, worms struggled to snatch them out of the sky, but mostly they were too slow to catch the dropships. Galliana's people manned their cannon positions and did their best to fend off as many as they could. Clavain clutched his gun, not firing yet. Best to save his ammo cell power for a target he stood a chance of injuring. Above, the first dropships made hairpin turns, nosing suicidally down towards the nest. Then they fractured cleanly apart, revealing falling pilots clad in bulbous armor. Just before the moment of impact, each pilot's armor exploded into a mass of black, shock-absorbing balloons, looking something like a blackberry bouncing across the nest before the balloons deflated just as swiftly to leave the pilot standing on the ground. By then the pilot, now properly a soldier, would have a comprehensive computer-generated map of the nest's nooks and crannies, enemy positions graphed in real time from the down-looking spysats. Clavain fell behind the curve of a dome before the nearest soldier got a lock on him. The firefight was beginning now. He had to hand it to Galliana's people. They were fighting like devils. And they were at least as well coordinated as the attackers, but their weapons and armor were simply inadequate. Camelioflage was only truly effective against a solitary enemy or a massed enemy moving in from a common direction. With coalition forces surrounding him, Clavain's suit was going crazy trying to match every background, like a chameleon in a house of mirrors. The sky overhead looked strange now, darkening purple, and the purple was spreading in a mist across the nest. Galliana had deployed some kind of chemical smoke screen, infrared and optically opaque, he guessed. It would occlude the spysats and might be primed to adhere only to enemy camelioflage. That had never been in Warren's simulations. Galliana had just given herself the slightest of edges. A soldier stepped out of the mist, the obscene darkness of a gun muzzle trained on Clavain. His camelioflage armor was dappled with vivid purple patches, ruining its stealthiness. The man fired, but his discharge wasted itself against Clavain's armor. Clavain returned the compliment, dropping his compatriot. What he had done, he thought, was not technically treason, not yet. All he had done was act in self-preservation. The man was wounded, but not yet dead. Clavain stepped through the purple haze and knelt down beside the soldier. He tried not to look at the man's wound. "Can you hear me?" he said. There was no answer from the man, but beneath his visor, Clavain thought he saw the man's lips shape a word. The man was just a kid, hardly old enough to remember much of the last war. "There's something you have to know," Clavain continued. "Do you realize who I am?" He wondered how recognizable he was under the breather mask. Then something made him relent. He could tell the man he was Neville Clavain. But what would that achieve? The soldier would be dead in minutes, maybe sooner than that. Nothing would be served by the soldier knowing that the basis for his attack was a lie, that he would not in fact be laying down his life for a just cause. The universe could be spared a single callous act. "Forget it," Clavain said, turning away from his victim. And then he moved deeper into the nest, to see who else he could kill before the odds took him. But the odds never did. "You were always very lucky," Galliana said, leaning over him. They were somewhere underground again, deep in the nest. A medical area, by the look of things. He was on a bed, fully clothed, apart from the outer layer of camelioflage armor. The room was gray and kettle-shaped, ringed by a circular balcony.
"What happened?"
"You took a head wound, but you'll survive." He groped for the right question.
"What about Warren's attack?"
"We endured three waves. We took casualties, of course." Around the circumference of the balcony were 30 or so gray couches, slightly recessed into archways, studded with grey medical equipment. They were all occupied. There were more conjoiners in this room than he had seen so far in one place. Some of them looked very close to death. Clavain reached up and examined his head gingerly. There was some dried blood on the scalp, matted with his hair, some numbness, but it could have been a lot worse. He felt normal, no memory dropouts or aphasia. When he pushed himself up to sitting and tried to stand, his body obeyed his will with only a tinge of dizziness.
"Warren won't stop at just three waves, Galliana."
"I know." She paused. "We know there'll be more." He walked to the railing on the inner side of the balcony and looked over the edge.
He had expected to see something, some chunk of incomprehensible surgical equipment, perhaps, but the middle of the room was only an empty, smooth-walled grey pit. He shivered. The air was colder than in any part of the nest he had visited so far, with a medicinal tang that reminded him of the convalescence ward on Deimos. What made him shiver even more was the realization that some of the injured, some of the dead, were barely older than the children he had visited only hours ago. Perhaps some of them were, those children, conscripted from the nursery since his visit, uploaded with fighting reflexes through their new implants.
"What are you going to do? You know you can't win. Warren lost only a tiny fraction of his available forces in those waves. You look as if you've lost half your nest."
"It's much worse than that," Galliana said.
"What do you mean?"
"You're not quite ready yet, but I can show you in a moment." He felt colder than ever now.
"What do you mean, not quite ready?"
Galliana looked deeply into his eyes now. "You suffered a serious head injury, Clavain. The entry wound was small, but the internal bleeding, it would have killed you, had we not intervened." Before he could ask the inevitable question, she answered it for him. "We injected a small cluster of medicines into your head. They undid the damage very easily, but it seemed provident to allow them to grow."
"You've put replicators in my head."
"You needn't sound so horrified. They're already growing, spreading out and interfacing with your existing neural circuitry, but the total volume of glial mass they will consume is tiny, only a few cubic millimeters in total, across your entire brain." He wondered if she was calling his bluff.
"I don't feel anything."
"You won't. Not for a minute or so." Now she pointed into the empty pit in the middle of the room. "Stand here and look into the air."
"There's nothing there."
But as soon as he had spoken, he knew he was wrong. There was something in the pit. He blinked and directed his attention somewhere else. But when he returned his gaze to the pit, the thing he imagined he had seen, milky, spectral, was still there, and becoming sharper and brighter by the second. It was a three-dimensional structure, as complex as an exercise in protein folding, a tangle of loops and connecting branches and nodes and tunnels embedded in a ghostly red matrix. Suddenly he saw it for what it was, a map of the nest dug into Mars. Just as the Coalition had suspected, the base was far more extensive than the original structure, reaching deeper and further out than anyone had imagined. Clavain made a mental effort to retain some of what he was seeing in his mind, the intelligence-gathering reflex stronger than the conscious knowledge that he would never see Deimos again. "The medicines in your brain have interfaced with your visual cortex," Galliana said. "That's the first step on the road to trans-enlightenment. Now you're privy to the machine-generated imagery encoded by the fields through which we move.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.